And our first speaker today is Chai Wei Wang. She's a graduate student here in the astronomy department, working with Avalov's as her advisor. And today she will talk to us about star formation fronts and filaments during cosmic dawn.
Okay, thank you, Kamiya. So, hello everyone. Thanks to the snow cancellation a while ago, I'm able to present our more recent work on the self-sustaining star formation fronts in filaments during cosmic dawn. Okay, so our first motivation of working on this paper is due to the shortage of ionizing photons at high redshift. So a significant population of star formation galaxies beyond a redshift of 10 or so is required to explain the Thomson optical depth of the cosmic background, microwave background. And a likely compensating factor for this shortage of ionizing photon is a population of faint low-mass halos observationally suggested by this very steep faint and slope of the rest frame UV luminosity function. And so we know that due to the low metallicity and low temperature environment of high redshift low mass halos, star formation efficiency is suggested to be very low. And so this means that we need some sort of new mechanisms for efficient star formation in these low mass halos at high redshift. Okay, so our second motivation is really about the question of whether galactic outflows can affect their neighboring halos. So we know that galactic outflows are important as a role in the formation and evolution of low-mass galaxies, and they're crucial in regulating star formation and also the enrichment of the CGM or the intergalactic medium, IGM. And observationally, these outflows are identified in multiphase, so from molecular outflows all the way in X-ray. And also, a very recent observation indicates that there is ongoing star formation within the outflow. So that means the outflowing shell can fragment into star very rapidly. However, all the previous studies are limited to the scale of the outflow or host galaxies or the CGM around the galaxy, and the question of whether or how these outflows can affect their neighboring halo is still uncertain. Okay, so in this work, we proposed a new model of the ignition of star formation in low-mass halos that otherwise do not form stars themselves. such halos are often distributed in cosmic filaments, as seen in this image, simulation image. So we consider the halos whose viral temperature is just right below the cooling threshold temperature for star formation. And we considered two cases. The first one is 200 Kelvin, which corresponds to the cooling threshold temperature of molecular hydrogen. And the other one is 10 to the 4 Kelvin, which is the cooling temperature for atomic hydrogen. And so these low-mass halos at high redshift cannot cool and initiate star formation. And in our model, we propose that a passing shockwave can trigger the star formation and then generate a self-sustaining starburst in the filaments. Okay. So before I get to the model, I just wanted to qualitatively show how closely these low-mass halos are distributed at high redshift. So you can see that the red lines correspond to the viral radius of these halos, so essentially their size. And we can estimate the average separation of these low-mass halos using the halo mass function, so as shown in the blue lines, where we derive the average separation of low-mass halos using the Prats-Schechter mass function and the Schess-Tormann function. And halos in filaments are suggested to be even closer than the average separation, so up to a few times, up to a factor of 10 or so. So you can see in both, for both cooling threshold, the separation of these halos is comparable to their Vera radius, so their size. So this means that in our model, we just assume that these low mass halos are tightly packed in a halo. So in a configuration like this, this is like a beans on a string kind of structure. So these are the quiescent low mass halos that cannot form stars themselves. And then let's assume somewhere in the filaments, there is an outflow, propagates supersonically and sweep up the ambient medium with a speed of a few hundred kilometers per second. And then the shells swept up by the outflow tend to cool rapidly and fragment into cold clumps that form stars. I'll get back to the star formation later. And then, again, the shock, the outflow, in turn, is rejuvenated as it gains energy from the new supernova explosions, which sustain its propagation. Okay, so the propagation of this self-sustaining shock, we call it the star formation front, is analogous to a detonation wave, such as the explosion of highly explosive scum powders and etc., which is essentially a igniting shock that drives exothermal reactions. So in the case of a detonation wave, the energy source is the chemical reaction in the highly explosives. And in our case of the star formation front, the energy provider is the supernova explosion from the newly formed stars triggered by the outflow. Okay, so as I said, we can make analogy to the detonation wave and write down the equations describing the flow. So I'm pretty sure that these equations look kind of familiar to you. So this is the reactive Euler equation of high-speed flows coupled to energy release. And so you see the continuity equation, momentum equation, energy equation, and the last equation here describes the chemical reaction in the case of the detonation wave. And in our case, this would correspond to star formation rate. So here we have introduced a parameter here, lambda, which is the stellar mass fraction. So in this plot, in this setup, so if you turn this model 90 degrees anti-clockwise, you would see this. So we see here that this is the shock front, and then we see the quiescent halos that cannot form stars themselves in front of the shock front. And then behind the shock is the active star formation zone. So as I said, lambda corresponds to the stellar mass fraction. So because in front of the shock front, there is no star formation, so this corresponds to lambda equals zero. And then somewhere behind the shock front, at the boundary of the star formation zone, lambda equals one. So that means the star formation is complete. So here the rate law essentially describes how fast the star formation goes. And in the case of the detonation wave, it describes how fast does the chemical reaction goes. So you can see we can actually derive the rate law from the Kennicott-Schmidt law. And then here I have converted the observed surface density to volume density. And then you can derive, if you plug this back in here, you can derive that this is a power law proportional to the pressure of the gas and also the stellar mass fraction, or equivalently gas mass fraction. Okay. So in the energy equation here, we adopted a polytropic equation of state where the internal energy is also related to lambda, which is the stellar mass function. So also Q. Q is the energy produced per supernova per unit mass. So we have included a numerical factor that accounts for the initial mass function, because we're considering very high redshift, and so we need to add this factor for pop 3 stars and so. And then FSN is another free parameter which considers how much energy from supernova explosions can be injected to the shock. And then ESN is how much energy does one supernova explosion produce. And then omega is how much mass we need to produce a supernova explosion. Okay, so because of our geometry setup, we consider a two-dimensional cylindrical geometry. And because solving these equations would be really messy, so we just consider the steady-state solution, and then we can get rid of the partial t part of this equation. Even so, these partial differential equations will be very messy to solve. So here I am using a mathematical trick. So as you can see here, I used a straight streamline assumption. So basically, I just assume that the streamlines behind the shock are straight, even though they're diverging, they're still straight. So the advantage of this assumption is that, so if you expand these equations in the coordinates of R and Z, and then you can make a coordinate transformation, so you can use a streamline-based coordinates. And then under this assumption, these PDEs will essentially become ODEs, ordinary differential equations, along each streamline. So we can basically solve these equations along each streamline, and then we can get the full solution behind the shock. Okay. So just a quick summary of the free parameters and their fiducial values. So let's go back to these equations. Okay, so as I said, we can derive the power law indices from Kennicott-Schmidt law, and then we pretty much fix that in our calculation. And then we also fixed ESN and omega SN to their fiducial values for a very massive initial mass function. And then we leave this guy as a free parameter for pop 3 stars. And then this guy is also a free parameter in our model, and also this guy. Okay, so before I jump to the numerical results, I wanted to mention the star formation process triggered by this shock. So as I said, the shock sweeps up the ambient medium, and then the outflowing shell can cool rapidly via thermal instability, which occurs if the heating rate at a constant pressure rises faster than the cooling rate. And then the material that is slightly cooler than the surrounding medium will keep cooling down at a constant pressure. So in our previous paper, we have estimated the time scale, the cooling time scale of the shock material. So you can see the shock material cools down very fast. And it's the time scale is much shorter than the dynamical time scale of the outflow. And it's also shorter than the free fall time scale. So this means that the shells, the outflowing shells, can cool rapidly. So it's safe to assume that the subsequent star formation is on a time scale much shorter than the dynamical time scale. Okay, so again, I'm going back to the analogy with the detonation wave. The simplest detonation model would be a one-dimensional detonation wave. So this is known as the Z and D model in fluid dynamics. So, which says that basically the steady state detonation speed is only proportional to how much energy is injected to sustain the shock. And now we are considering a two-dimensional detonation wave, and things get a little bit more complicated because due to the limitation of the size of the halo, so we get a sort of the so-called diameter effect in detonation. So, so you can imagine intuitively, the smaller the size of the halo, okay, so the smaller the size of the halo, the harder it is for the shock to propagate. So this results in an inversely proportional relation between the steady state detonation velocity and the size of your halo. And this is what we see. So I have plotted the steady state detonation solution as the function of the redshift. As you can see, if you go to a redshift beyond 10, for both cooling threshold, you still get a star formation front with a speed around 300 to 500 or so. And if you compare this to the ideal 1D case, you can see that we're losing a significant fraction of energy due to the lateral expansion on the radial direction. Okay, so here we are interested in the question that beyond what redshift does our detonation regime fail? So here I'm showing the critical redshift beyond which we don't get detonation. So if you go back to this plot, because I forgot to mention that the zero radius of the halo is... So the larger the redshift, the smaller the viral radius of the low mass halos. So this means that if you go to really high redshift, you don't get the detonation because the steady state velocity will drop significantly. And then we explored a wide range in the parameter space. So we explored, if you remember, epsilon star is related to the star formation rate. And then these two parameters are related to how much energy does the supernova how much energy does the supernova inject back to sustain the shock? So you can see even for really small values, apart from the fiducial values of our model, we still get detonation around a redshift of 10 or so. So if you look at redshift of 20, which is pretty much when the reionization begins, you see we still get detonation for really large range of parameter values. Okay, so I just wanted to show quickly that the mass trick I mentioned essentially gives you the full solution of the flow behind the shock front. So here, I plotted the position of the shock. So these are like snapshots. And then for different redshift and different cooling threshold temperatures. So you can see the shock front is curved in a two-dimensional geometry. And then we can see how the density, pressure, and axial flow velocity drops behind the shock front. And here I'm showing the radial flow velocity. So you can see that we are essentially losing a significant fraction of energy due to this lateral expansion. And then these dotted lines are the streamlines. So you can see that this assumption is pretty consistent with the calculation of this model. Okay. So our conclusion is that we propose a brand new model for the ignition of star formation in low mass halos at high redshift. And the the shell swept up by the shock can cool and fragmentate rapidly, that subsequently form stars, and then the shock is sustained by the energy injection from the new supernova explosions in a scenario similar to the detonation wave. And we find that at high redshift, the star formation fronts can propagate with an average speed of 300 to 700 kilometers per second. And hopefully future observations by JWST on the filaments can tell us something about the star formation rate in these low-mass halos, as well as the initial mass function. All right, thank you.
Okay, so I'm a little confused about the source terms.
Okay.
In the energy and momentum equations. Would you mind going back
sure.
to that? I'm hoping you can just talk me out of my confusion. Okay, so this energy and momentum injection from the supernovae is presumably a source term on the right-hand sides of those equations.
Yes.
And what I'm a tiny bit confused about is if the cooling time is so short in this post-shock region, is the cooling of the supernova ejecta affecting the way in which they're depositing, say, thermal energy as opposed to momentum into this outflow? How does that affect the sort of propagation of this blast wave?
Okay, so...
Does that make sense?
I get your point. So here we have verified that the cooling of the swept up or shocked gas is substantially shorter than the dynamical timescale of the shock. Mm-hmm. And then we pretty much assume instantaneous formation of the molecular clouds. So once you have the molecular clouds, and then this gives you how fast we get stars from those molecular clouds. Mm-hmm. So here you can see it's still it's not instantaneous. It's related to how much stars you already have in the medium and also the pressure. So this equation is coupled to basically all the other equations.
Agreed. Yeah, and I guess I'm asking then when they supernovae explode, shown that those conditions are such that cooling is very effective. So how does that cooling affect the ability of this sort of front to self-sustain? Are you not sort of robbing energy from behind the shockwave?
We had a numerical factor that considers how much energy is effectively ejected into the shock, right? So this is included in this parameter here. And then we have verified that, you know, the fiducial value from numerical simulation is a quarter, but we have verified that even if you go down to 10 to the negative 3, you still get this detonation. Okay.
Let's thank Hawaii again.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Sophia Marshall. She's a postdoc here since last year. Before that, she did her PhD in and today she will talk about radiological coronal.
Okay. Thank you all for being here for the very last talk of the seminars, of the seminar series, if I'm not mistaken. And thanks a lot, Antonia and Morgan, for organizing this event. All right, let me press play here. So the title of my talk today is Modeling Radio Loud Coronal Mass Ejections, and I am very excited to share with you today our newly developed radiosynthetic imaging tool, which is integrated in state-of-the-art three-dimensional MHD simulations of the solar wind and CMEs. This is a work in collaboration with the usual suspects here at the CFA, as well as our collaborators at the University of Michigan and UMass Lowell. I would like to begin stating the overarching problem, which is no other than the energy partition between flares and CMEs. And for the Sun, we are in the very fortunate position that we can directly observe both flares and CMEs. This is, though, not really the case for other stars. We have a plethora of observations of flares for other stars, but this is not the case for CMEs. So it's really important to go back to the Sun and establish and understand better the relation between flares and CMEs and how the energy of an active region is partitioned between these two phenomena. But what really are flares and what are CMEs? So flares are really emission. It's really emission in different wavelengths and different frequencies and so on. And CMEs are really a chunk of mass that is being ejected away from the Sun in a particular speed. So the question comes down to how much of the energy that is available in an active region goes to radiation energy and how much goes to kinetic energy. Now, the link between flares and CMEs is the magnetic reconnection. And as shown in this very pretty schematic from Contar et al., we see that as the accelerated particles move downwards from the acceleration site, they interact with the material that pre-existed there, and they really emit emission throughout the entire electromagnetic spectrum. Flares are really multi-frequency, multi-wavelength beasts. We have emission from hard X-rays to soft X-rays, through EUV and optical light, and radio emission, which will be the focus of my talk today. So, inspired by the solar association between type 2 radio bursts and CME shock fronts, the stellar community now believes that the most promising method to incontrovertibly observe stellar CMEs are type 2 radio bursts. Type 2 radio bursts have this very characteristic pattern in the dynamic spectrum. They characteristically drift in frequency, and this has to do purely with the fact that as CMEs propagate outwards, they also expand. Now, why radio? Our initial motivation when started working on this subject was to provide a computational tool to interpret stellar CME observations through radio, from type 2 radio bursts. And this, as you can understand, becomes more important in the context of the plethora of the newly discovered exoplanetary environments. But furthermore, radio frequencies have a favorable atmospheric window for ground observations, and this gives us access to a plethora of radio sources from cosmological down to planetary scales. Finally, something that became more clear to me after I started working with this project was that there is really a wide range of mechanisms that can produce radio emission. These radio emission mechanisms range from Bremsstrahlung radiation, which has a square density dependence, and it has a weak dependence on temperature as well, and is really the easiest radio emission mechanism that one could model. Moving to gyromagnetic radiation, so taking into account magnetic fields, and this mechanism is due to the Lorentz force. And finally, moving to plasma radiation, which is the most difficult mechanism to model. And the plasma radiation is created when non-equilibrium velocity distribution functions trigger plasma waves, which are then converted to electromagnetic emission. Two very important phenomena under this category are electron beams and CMHD shock waves, which are associated with type 3 and type 2 radio bursts, respectively. Today, I will discuss a particular event for most of my talk that took place in March 2011. I am showing here Stereo B observations from the solar disk as well as coronagraph views. Interestingly enough, the EUV emission has the same density, the EUV brightness has the same density dependence, square density dependence, just like the Bremsstrahlung emission. So this is a very extended event. It extends more than 270 degrees. All right. Dynamic spectra are the most compact way we have to visualize the radio information. And this is because when we stack the frequencies in time, then radio bursts have the possibility to reveal their very characteristic patterns, which have to do with the way that they drift in frequency. And they are associated then with particular events, such as the ones that I mentioned earlier. Now, moving to our tool, we have developed a radio synthetic imaging tool as part of the space weather modeling framework. In particular, we are using BatchRS to run three-dimensional MHD realistic simulations, including Alvin wave heating. For our CMEs, in this study, we are using a Gibson Low type of flux rope eruptive model. And this study is based on an earlier work published by Benkiewicz et al. 2010, which has been adjusted to include spherical grid and AMR capabilities. Our tool computes the radio intensity concurrently with the MHD simulation. And we allow for two different possibilities. We can create synthetic radio images, either integrating along the line of sight or along the actual curved ray paths. We have implemented the Bremsstrahlung emission consistently on top of a pre-existing artificial mechanism, which was really the non-thermal deviation from the Bremsstrahlung emission, which I will not really discuss in this talk. Moving back to solar observations, we know that the solar disk appears to have a very different view according to what frequency it's being observed at, ranging from an extended fuzzable image down to a smaller, more refined solar disk. This was already understood and explained in 1999 due to the fact that higher frequency rays are able to penetrate deeper in the solar atmosphere, and thus they have access to stronger magnetic fields and they can pick up the structures there. In other words, this is due to refraction, which is very important for the radio frequencies, and we should not ignore it. And refraction is governed by the density gradient. The density gradient is particularly important in a stratified medium such as the solar atmosphere. And it works like this. So we have a particular ray of a specific frequency that moves towards the sun. And as the density increases, it starts curving away until it meets a specific critical surface, below which it really cannot penetrate. So this critical surface is showing the solar disk size for different frequencies. Higher frequencies have a critical surface closer to the sun. So we understand that for higher frequencies, the sun appears to have a smaller size, whereas in lower frequencies, it's more fuzzy and more extended. Okay, now moving to our results. We are able to produce synthetic images of the desired size with respect to our simulated domain. And we are able also to locate our observer wherever we want in the three-dimensional space. All the views that I will discuss in this particular talk are as seen from the Earth, which is really a natural choice for the sun. So here I'm showing actual the results of our simulation, and we can see, moving from low frequencies to high frequencies, that we are able to reproduce this extended fuzzable image in low frequencies to a smaller disk and more topologically refined in higher frequencies. So qualitatively, we already feel better for ourselves. But we can also really quantify the size and the extent of the disk, as well as the intensity structures that are picked up by your code, doing this simple manipulation that I'm showing here, just plotting the intensity along particular lines, for example. But we have also validated our model against observations, in particular at 17 gigahertz from Nobuyama observations. On your left-hand side, I'm showing the intensity computed by our simulation, and on the right-hand side, I have overplotted the intensity contours from our simulation on top of actual observations from Nobuyama at 17 gigahertz. I think we agree that there is a quite good correspondence between the two. And moving towards the two different capabilities that we allow, that is integrating along the line of sight or along the actual curved ray paths, I'm showing on the left-hand side the refracted and line of sight integration on top of each other to emphasize the differences and similarities. On the top right-hand side, I'm showing the refracted ray, and on the lower right-hand side, I'm showing what we get when we ignore refraction. We see that the differences between the two cases are quite substantial, both for the disk and for the body of the CME. We see when we ignore the refraction that the disk does not appear that extended anymore and has a high intensity ring around it. We also see that the body of the CME, the intensity of the body of the CME appears quite different as well, having a peak for the line of sight integration at the center of the CME, where we have a cavity for the refracted case. So when we are interested, especially for the solar case, to really pinpoint in a three-dimensional fashion our radio sources, we really cannot ignore refraction. It makes a substantial difference. Now, we are really able to perform, at this point, we are really able to perform temporal evolution studies of CMEs, as I'm showing here, in different frequencies. And you can notice here that even though the CME leaves the domain quite early, we are, for example, able, in particularly in low frequencies, to examine the radio wave behind the CME similarly to what is done to what is observed for EUV waves in the sun, for the EUV waves that are just behind the CME, and they expand outwards towards the solar surface. And we see here that both the CME and the disk in lower frequencies, they appear as more extended features, whereas for higher frequencies, we see that smaller scale structures are being picked up, and for the body of the CME, they're mostly associated with the CME foot points. Finally, we are able to construct dynamic spectra from a single simulation, so we can stack our radio frequencies with time and examine their the looks of it from the intensity. Nevertheless, this will become more physically interesting once we actually include the non-thermal emission mechanisms, and then we can really study the different types of bursts and so on. So this is a good experiment for the moment in showing our capabilities, but it will be more interesting in the future. So to conclude, we have developed a radio synthetic imaging tool, and we have integrated it in three-dimensional state-of-the-art MHD simulations. It's the first time that the role of refraction can be so systematically examined and in a three-dimensional fashion. And while we're already able to produce dynamic spectra, this will become way more physically interesting once we actually include the burst-like emission mechanisms. I hope that I have already convinced you that this is a really valuable tool and we can advance our physical knowledge from this. Nevertheless, our ultimate goal remains to include non-thermal emission mechanisms so that we will be able to study type 2 and type 3 radio bursts. This will allow us to reach our full capabilities and will give us the flexibility to switch on and off different radio emission mechanisms and examine their relative importance in different setups. Finally, this is a really good timing for our tool, taking into account solar Orbiter and Parker Solar Probe BLAST that will be launched very soon this year. And they will have new space radio capabilities. And hopefully, we will also help to move towards a more three-dimensional picture of the radio sources, at least for the Sun. Thank you. I think I was very fast. Was I?
Yes. Including the Type 2 emission, you're planning to use the Schmidt and Carnes formalism?
That they did the similar experiment on top of the MHD and Batsaras code, that's what you're referring to? Yeah, so we actually don't know yet because, for example, from their papers, I don't think it's abundantly clear exactly how they do this, but the way that, I'm sorry?
I agree.
You agree? Okay. So the way that we have in mind for and how we have already, for example, incorporated the Bremsstrahlung emission is through the emissivity. But we all know it's a very easy spectrum for the Bremsstrahlung emission, whereas, for example, for the plasma emission and so on, it's such a complicated mess over there. So the way we have in mind to do this is to take an approximate spectrum. People have done this, for example, having a particular dependence on the MHD quantities and the magnetic field and the density and so on. So that's how we have this in mind for the moment. Yeah.
So do you do polarization?
We do not do polarization. That would be great if we could do that, but I think that's the next step after the type 2 bursts, I suppose.
Like, have you looked into it at all? Or?
We don't have this capability at the moment, so We need to code this up. It would be amazing, though, indeed, and it would give a lot of information.
Yeah, it's really nasty, though. It's like, as far as I can tell, the molecules propagate differently, and so it kills and stuff.
What? So what's the nasty about it? I suppose it's nasty.
You need to calculate the normal modes of your plasma,
okay.
And the dispersion relations are different, and so your different modes propagate differently, and you can't actually use like the Stokes formalism because you have to model the two.
Yeah, I take your, like we didn't even started planning to do this, to be honest, because of all the complexity that you're more used to dealing with, I guess.
What exactly will you, in the future, what exactly will convince you that you're seeing a particular form of coronal mass ejection, for example, on another star? So, if you're looking at kind of like the integral quantities rather than the specially resolved quantities, what do you anticipate being most helpful?
So our philosophy first is to understand what's happening in the Sun. And I think there, for example, we are able for the moment to produce two-dimensional images from our three-dimensional runs of the CME structure. I don't think I convince many people when I say that this is how the CME looks in radio, because this is obviously only the Bremsstrahlung emission taken into account. But and it's very, very difficult, for example, for the solar case to have three-dimensional observational studies of the CMEs.
Yeah.
And this has only recently started to happen. So with all the amazing instruments that are now in our hands, the community starts, I just read like a couple of very recent papers, like 2018 or so, that they're really starting to three-dimensionally pinpoint the radio sources. So I think we are already helping towards this direction with our three-dimensional simulation and all the information that's in there to understand this kind of observations. And then for the stellar part, there hasn't been yet a verification of, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, of a type 2 radio burst observation yet. And when this happens, I think we can then start saying that, first of all, this is plausible for the observational part. And on the other hand, we can, when we run, so this is from the observational perspective. From the simulation perspective, we will be able, when we run a stellar case, so a stellar magnetic field and stellar, as people have done before, as Cecilia has done, for example, for other stars, then we might be able to say which frequencies are possible for the particular mechanism to be observed at. Because at the moment, it's kind of, they have surveys, but it's sort of you know, there might be issues that are not taken into account, so it's just not feasible for the moment to really observe the type 2 radio bursts in the frequencies observed.
But your plasma, your dynamic spectrum looks good, where I think the one of the things that people talk about is if you have an extrasolar CME, you get some plasmoid that's, you know, propagating through, and so it's expanding, and so you expect to see this characteristic, you know, plasma emission that moves to solar frequencies as it propagates outward. And so you, the hope is to see one of those kind of curves as with the right time scales.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the frequency drifts and so on. Mm-hmm.
So empirically, how bright is the brownstone compared to the further emission?
Compared to?
Like the plasma emission?
I think what's interesting is what region you're observing and what frequencies you're observing it at. So I think typically that the type, the bursts, so type 2 radio bursts, come on, movie. Okay. Here. So it's in the order of megahertz, whereas, for example, for the disk, we know that in the orders of gigahertz, this is the Bremsstrahlung more important down to the quiescent emission. But really, it's like megahertz, few tens or so, and it drifts quite fast or so. Whereas I don't know what are the main frequencies that are being observed in for stellar case, if you know, Peter.
I think, I mean, like, the low-frequency telescopes are, you know, sort of the LDMA and the sort of tens of megahertz.
Yeah, tens of megahertz.
Yeah.
So that's typically what we see for the sun, for example.
Yeah, I mean, people try at L-band, like, gigahertz, but the interesting stuff is at the low frequency, the ionosphere.
Yeah. It's a bummer for the moment. Right.
So you probably mentioned this, but I think I missed it. I'm sorry. That time series that you showed of the event from 2001, what wavelength range was that?
From 2000. So this one?
No, you had like a video.
So that was a UV.
Oh, that was UV. Okay, so there is...
I'm just showing it because, as I said, they have the very interesting common characteristic that their intensities depend on square density in both cases. So we can really compare Bremsstrahlung with the UV.
So there is no continuous monitoring of the sun in the radio?
There is. So there is, for example, for high frequencies, there is no Nobiyama. And there isn't, like, in a systematic way as done in SDO, so I don't think you can go in a website and, for example, as the Solar Dynamic Observatory is showing, every day you can take everything you want. Only Nobiyama has such incredible, so it's higher frequencies normally. For lower frequency, you need to run the campaign and...
Fund phaser.
I'm sorry? Fund phaser? What's that? It allows this kind of capability?
Agile solar radio array. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
You should take your microphone off.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
Totally forgot.
What is it here? Okay. Turn it off, like...